William Huntington Russell was one of the more prominent merchants involved in the Chinese opium trade. Born in America, Russell did what most wealthy businessmen did during the Industrial Revolution: protect his assets from taxation by establishing a tax-free foundation. The tax-free foundation that Russell and Company established based on opium revenue was the Russell Trust. The key institution of indoctrination that Russell Trust established was Skull and Bones. Skull and Bones was founded at Yale University in 1832 as a black lodge of Freemasonry. The odds that both presidential candidates would happen to be members of Skull and Bones is approximately 1 in 750,000.
You both were members of Skull and Bones, a secret society at Yale. What does that tell us?
Not much, because it's a secret.
Is there a secret handshake? Is there a secret code?
I wish there were something secret I could manifest.
322, a secret number?
There are all kinds of secrets, Tim, but one thing is not a secret. I disagree with this president's direction.
You were both in Skull and Bones, the secret society.
It's so secret we can't talk about it.
What does that mean for America? The conspiracy theorists are going to go wild.
I'm sure they are. I don't know. I haven't seen the web.
Number 322?
First of all, he's not the nominee. Look, I look forward...
Are you prepared to lose?
No, I'm not going to lose.
Three generations of the Bush family have been members of Skull and Bones. George W. Bush, his father George H.W. Bush, and his father before him, Prescott Bush, were all members of this occult secret society.
The videotape provides a grainy glimpse into what appear to be the initiation rituals of a secret society that's been around since 1832, whose members have gone on to be leaders of Wall Street and the White House, the Senate and the Supreme Court.
They're sort of trying to scare the initiates, make them, disorient them, frighten them.
New York Observer investigative reporter Ron Rosenbaum accompanied a team of Yale students who shot these pictures 9 days ago. Rosenbaum's curiosity about Skull and Bones was permanently piqued when, as a classmate of George W. Bush, he lived right next to the tomb, the group's heavily fortified home. From their perch, Rosenbaum and his cohorts taped the tomb's courtyard. What they captured, they say, was initiates, known as neophytes, being forced to kiss a skull, then members performing a mock killing. It may look like your average fraternity nonsense, but Rosenbaum says it's not.
Even though it may seem silly to us, it seems to mean something to them, and you can't argue with the success of Skull and Bones.
It has been alleged by members of Skull and Bones that it was Prescott Bush who stole the skull and bones of Indian Chief Geronimo and placed it in the tomb as a source of spiritual power. George W. Bush never apologized for his activities in Skull and Bones. One of the first things he did as president was appoint many of his fellow bonesmen to positions of power.
President Bush has tapped five fellow bonesmen to join his administration. Most recently, the head of the Securities and Exchange Commission, William Donaldson, Skull and Bones, 1953.
Does that relationship, forged with all this mumbo-jumbo and coffins and skulls and bones and all of that stuff, does that become, in some cases anyway, stronger than family, faith?
Absolutely. You know, they say the motto at Yale is for God, for country, and for Yale. At Bones, I would think it's for bones.